Welcome back, everybody, here to your broadcast of the MSI Beat It 2014 Global Challenge for the European Qualifiers, the lower bracket, first final. I'm Tubby One.
And I'm the Capitalist. I love being the co-caster, man. Life is so easy. I just sit there and just laugh as you're like, you keep on going more and more into the title, and I'm just sitting here, and all I have to do is to... And I'm the captain.
He actually has the easiest job in the world. Like, I'm worrying about the live stream. I'm worrying about, like, where the camera's got to
be. I'm on Twitter. I'm just, like, messing around. Like, what's new on Reddit? Hey, listen. It makes up for all the amateur Dota I've been covering while you were on Joy Dota Reddit.
That is true.
That is true. 10-minute GG calls.
At the same time, I've been having to do other meetings and other calls, which I know you would never, ever want to be a part of. So...
It's true. I was specifically speaking when you were streaming on Joined Out Red, and I was streaming on Joined Out Blue, though. Because I you think that to this morning was a novelty? You think this morning was new? 10-minute GG call and a 13-minute GG call
You
right
know
after
that's happening
another?
Tomorrow, too, because you're doing MSI Beat It from 10 a.m. in the morning on Joined Out Blue!
Yeah, so if you guys want some quick, fast action... Check it out, 10 a.m. tomorrow morning.
It's actually the MSI Beta Chinese qualifiers tomorrow morning. So it's on Jordan Blue. I'm doing the I-League Chinese qualifiers on Jordan Red.
Yeah, but I think it's kind of already... only one day, so you're probably still going to have
some. Yeah, it's still the second day, so we're still going to have a couple of people. But there are teams like Invictus Gaming playing in that one. It's like, ooh, that could be interesting.
Yeah, that's true.
But let's get ourselves into this game. Now, we had ourselves a delay of about 20 minutes before we started today. For this game, after a couple of other problems early tonight, because Virtus Pro ended up in a roughly 70-minute to 75-minute game. They've only just come out of that, so they're going to be rather tired. Hilariously enough, they were actually playing a Tinker in that game too, but they also still had their carry Jakiro player. So I'm interested to see how VP will approach this one, while Team Coast, we're going for Classico right now. Skywrath Mage faces Void together.
Yeah, combo, man. But I'm more concerned about the fact that we just saw like this early Tinker pickup here for Virtus Pro. Every single game that I have casted Virtus Pro so far with this new squad has been all about like push. Mm. Then we had like you said, they had a 74 minute game, something like that. I thought they were going to continue to go for the push until somebody really shut them down, but apparently they want to experiment with some other strategies, so that's fair enough. And once again, we're going to get the Jada Morana. Yeah. Solid on that one. He's the drafter right now, so he wants that hero, man. He wants him to himself. He's like, listen, I am one of the best roaming Moranas around town. I'm grabbing it for myself, all right?
This is when it's good to be the king.
Exactly. When you get to pick your own hero in the first one, too. Make sure it doesn't get banned out. The Shadow Shaman and Earthshaker are going to be banned away by Team Coast, while the Wraith King, obviously from Virtus Pro, the Wraith King, Skywrath Mage, everybody seems to love that combo.
It's already too much to try and deal with, so...
Yeah. And then the Earthshaker, Shadow Shaman are both really good setup heroes for the Morana, so...
Would you believe VP banned out the combination, which was allowed through in the last game? Because we almost had an exact copy of Team Coast's last draft if they had those two come through.
Yeah, it wrecked them, man. Yep. It wrecked them. And I can't believe it was fifth pick, too. That was just like, I was like going along. We were talking about the draft. And we're like, I think we were talking about the other team, and it was just like, all of a sudden, Team Coast pick up the fifth pick, Death Prophet. I'm just like, what? What do you mean? How is that hero still left in the pool? There's a Faceless Void. They picked it up early on. But
Jakiro. Yeah. I don't know why I get so happy to see Jakiro support players at core. I think it's actually because, like, you remember that weird obsession I had with Pugna back, like, maybe 4 months ago.
This is basically the fallout of kind of EMS remaining. 1 to some extent, right?
To a point, yes. Yeah, that was actually when it started to tail off. Yeah. It tailed off EMS 1,
it was way, way back.
Yeah, EMS 1,
it started
yes.
there with VG Gaming stopping with Pugna.
It tailed off at ESL 1 when people stopped doing it. That's amazing. We can go from one event to the other. Yeah. But yeah, because it was like, yes, Pugna pickup, all games, 20 minutes. And then Jakiro kind of like adds the same kind of flavor to the mix. You get the high level up in the liquid fire, and you just take towers by yourself. And the way VP run it, they go like max liquid fire as early as you possibly can. ice path up as much as you can as well. Screw having breathe fire. You want a tanky Chikiro that just sits on the bottom lane going, oh, you're rotating to actually help out your other teammates, are you? I'll take your towers. And it's just liquid fire, liquid fire, liquid fire. And that's it. It's the secret to the VP lineup. And what are you supposed to do? Come down and gank a Chikiro? He's the highest strength gaining support hero in the game.
Yeah.
Like, he's a really, really good hero for that kind of stuff. And I'm really concerned about Witch Doctor, too, because the Ice Path range is going to be really big. So if Chikiro's not called out inside the Chrono, then Witch Doctor, I don't think, is going to combo that nicely.
Yeah, they don't have many ways to really be able to push out against that Chikiro when he starts going in for those early Tier 1 towers.
I realize, too, we have to give a shout-out to Admiral Bulldog. Not only is he a moderator, he's actually a subscriber. So if you want to Admiral Bulldog, you have now won yourself the right to call in to our casual talk data later.
This is true.
Well, we'll discuss important things.
Don't worry, Bulldog. The next pub we play, I'll carry you this time.
No, it's probably not happening.
You're a good player, man.
I'm a good player. Bulldog outshines me like by 100%. So
have
100 times, not 100%, 100 times. Bane. So there's our other support for it, because we knew we were going to be seeing a Morana support. We knew we were going to be seeing a Chikiro core. I think other people, like, if this was the first time looking at this draft, it wasn't Team Virtus Pro, you'd be going, oh, probably a Morana core, Chikiro support.
Yeah, but or you do like Morana Bane dual lane off lane, then Chikiro plus one on the safe lane, which could actually still be possible. It's just Jotamstar's taking a little bit more farm here than anybody else.
Yeah, so presumably we're going to have the Bane Morana is going to be your support combination.
They could run an aggro trial with that. Bane Morana and Chikiro all together up on the top lane. Up against a Wish of the Skywrath Mage, I know it's a little bit...
Plus, you don't know what the fifth pick is for... Well, no, wait. That's a Clockwork.
Yeah, that's a Clockwork.
So we actually do. It should be a one position faces Void.
Yeah.
Huh. Okay.
Yeah, that's a one Void. That's a clock off, unless you're going to go S4-ish kind of style and throw the clock in towards the mid lane.
Okay, this is kind of the same argument for the Faces Void that I had last game, being in the one position, which was the fact that the Faces Void, as an offlaner, he's really easily pushed, right? The Furion Enigma combo like just pushed him in really, really early on. The Faces Void as a one position can actually come online a little bit faster with, you know, all you kind of need is you'd like to be able to have Treads, Mask of Madness, and you can actually start fighting around a little bit around base around every single Chronosphere. So I can't agree with this.
10 seconds remaining.
I can't agree. We did get down with this. The Clockwork as the offlane here is a little iffy for me. Remaining. He has no real good way to be able to deal with this push. He has some initiation for the rest of his team, and he's a great hero to work with Skywrath Mage. That's really one good upside. But I'm concerned that this requires them to have their ultimates, right? This Chikiro push is going to come before you have your ultimates. They're going to start taking these towers very early on. And by the time you're really ready to fight, it might be that Chikiro already has his mech. That's the way BZZ builds it. He goes for early towers, picks up a very, very fast mech for his team.
Yep.
They get a whole bunch of team fight, and now they're going to add in a Bristleback. Well, I think everybody knows my feelings on that one. I love Bristleback with push lineups.
Yeah. Yeah, he's going to be really great. Now, you're actually getting him from, like, two sides. Like, we saw the Bristleback in our last game where he was forcing rotations to come and deal with him. And then Chikiro's going to be doing the same kind of thing. And while you're doing all of that trying to deal with the Chikiro and the Bristleback, you've got this Bane and Morana roaming around trying to find pickoffs. And you got a Tinker who's going to be like, farm time, man.
Mm-hmm.
Farm time. And a Queen of Pain up against a Tinker. I wish the Quap good luck with getting a lot of last hits in that middle lane while she's also worried about side ganking. I think warding is probably the greatest asset Team Coast could have in this game. They need to see where these rotations are coming from so they can be really, like, they have the supports where they need to be in those lanes. Or else we're just going to see, well, Bane and Morana could always just, like, stack and farm. Because they should be stacking for the Bristleback and the Tinker anyway. Like, both of them are capable of farming up stacks.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely for the Tinker. It's Tinker, usually the best thing about stacking for a Tinker is that he disappears from his lane right as many supports are looking to be able to gank him. And if you're just able to farm up your basic amount of gold, get your Soul Ring, and maybe Boots, and then move out of the lane into the jungle and farm up the rest of, like, maybe the last 1,500, maybe 1K gold in the jungle. Obviously, it's much harder to be able to find a Tinker, much harder to gank him when he's farming up his jungle or his Ancients. So it actually works out really well, not only just for extra farm for the Tinker, but also gives him a lot more security and safety during the time where Team Coast are going to be angling to try and pick him off. But at the same time, they don't necessarily have to rely on stacks here for the Tinker to be able to farm up. When they have this really early push lineup, this is going to get Tinker, if he doesn't die too much,
And if these pushes are successful, a very, very fast boots of travel and blink dagger due to all the early tower gold they're going to get.
Yellow's having a bit of a walk up. I'm going to switch the dire vision right now. And yeah, okay. All four, five here has walked into this one. So Coast will realize that they're coming up a very, very long way. They'll see that Yell's got sentry wards. Eight mother forced to move up, which I thought means he could get himself in range for a nightmare. But then again, when you've already fired the arrow, what's the point?
Exactly, yeah.
BZZ is also just stretching. He's actually going solo bottom lane. So we're going to have a Jakiro as a solo bottom lane hero up against the clockwork. Yol might come and join him, but I doubt. I think he's just here for the rune. And then they run an aggro tri-lane with Seedoy and technically just Bane and Morana could be roaming. Actually, is the Bane coming all the way down?
Well,
yeah, he is. Jolim's also rotating as well. Okay, so it's just the three cores in the lane and the two supports roaming. That's it. Yeah, Solomon, by the way, also still has the greatest clockwork set in history.
Yeah, absolutely.
If you don't own this bulldog, you suck.
Well, okay then. Jotam, I think he's still going to go back to, you know, his roaming Morana tendencies and probably still try and put some pressure on maybe even the off lane, but definitely on the middle lane. Try and get an early kill there. As you can see him, he's already setting up for an early arrow. And because they don't really need that much to be able to harass the clockwork. Jakiro by himself is able to put in a lot of harassment damage, so they don't necessarily need the full defensive tri-lane just to be able to keep Solon out. Besides the fact that Solon is already going to be able to make the lane push by doing this whole cogs trick that he has on the dire side.
Mm-hmm. Maybe VP have just done the greatest dodge they could have. Like, Jotam's moving back to stack. Yol is doing a pull on the bottom lane just to obviously find his levels and farm, but by showing all five heroes up on that top lane, it just means they can go about their own little business inside their jungle, and Coast have no intention of moving around. They know how aggressive they can get. But the fact that Bristleback has also managed to find, like, just a second level very early on, so he's got his Bristleback as well as his Quill Spray. Like, he can just grab the aggro here off Steph style if he wants to, or just continue to leech the experience off him.
Yeah, well, Centaur is a pretty bad hero versus Skywrath Mage, in my opinion, because the harassment, even a tanky hero like Centaur, he's got no fallback. Bristleback is very similar to Centaur in that he has no real good fallback. I mean, you could jungle, you can farm some stacks later on, but mainly you have to make the offlane
arrow
work.
E-skills won't walk into it. I thought for a moment if he did, he potentially could have gone down very quickly. Notice the gods holding on to two of his skill points. He's ready if he needs to. He can just, like, pop E-skills.
Yeah, always good for tinkers to hold on to their abilities because getting first blood is worth it over delaying your march in the machines at 100%. So, but going back to it, Bristleback is great because you can always turn your back against those harassing nukes because you'll always be able to see them coming. They're very slow, both the cask as well as the arcane bolt. So you're going to be able to actually reduce that damage quite a bit. But you notice that already the counter ward has been laid down to be able to block up the ancient stack. Jotam doesn't care, though, Jamie Jotam. He's looking for a courier snipe.
No, he's looking for E-skills.
He's got
himself an arrow, and E-skills doesn't come blink himself away from this one. And with the haste rune, he can be a little bit more aggressive there. And that's delaying the tangos, which are coming to E-skills. He doesn't even have his bottle of elf with his Queen of Pain just yet. And that's why I was like very uncertain about the ability for Queen of Pain to outlane God in this middle lane.
Look at bottom lane, though. Solon has just been trapped up.
Oh, that's not what you want to beat. Liquid Fire is going to tick him out in the Ice Blast as well. Well, the Ice Path holding him in position. And the Brainstab damage already did its work. So you give first blood over to BZZ. That's going to be some very early... Well, he doesn't even need Arcane Boost. That was always one great thing about the Jakiro build. Liquid Fire costs nothing.
Yep. So, no, yeah, I really don't think you should ever be going Arcane Boots on a Jakiro. Treads are actually a really great item for him because he's already naturally tanky. He's already doing a lot of right-click damage in a lot of these early team fights, so build on that by giving him some attack speed. And also the extra strength is also awesome for Jakiro. So that's the way BZZ has been running it in the past. He just becomes this kind of unstoppable hero, man. He is so hard to kill once he has treads and a mech. It's unbelievable.
God's still waiting for the perfect moment when he can kill off E-skills. Whilst Jotam just keeps roaming this Morana around. Are they looking to come up? Seedoy? He's trying to stay as close as he possibly. Did he just get the last hit there with a Quill Spray?
Yeah.
It might have been Seven Stars attack, but it looked like the yellow of the Seedoy.
If he did, well timed by him. Smoke gank, though, is going to be happening now by Coast. They have to shut down this Tinker, right? The Tinker's getting so much good amount of space here in this middle lane. Yeah. They need to put a stop to him now. I mean, he's 5Xing his lane compared to the Quap, who is only sitting at 10 CS. Yeah, you got to free up some room for him, man. Jotam, between Jotam and the laser harassment, Quap can't do anything in this matchup.
Wow. He used the concussive shot already, and now Yol, well, he'll Nightmare up over on Stemstyle, and E-Skills will jump himself in. With
nice
the
path.
Ice path, Yol, he's got some space here. Liquid Fire can slow down Solon as well, which means Yol, he needs a little bit more space, but Solon gets the last attack in. The four heroes to try and get this kill. Ice Path's coming off cooldown, and Tinker is watching me. I'll catch out two with this. The arrow's coming in two, and it connects on Stemstyle. Rocket Laser evaporates the Witch Doctor, and Jotam, well, unfortunately for him, he wasn't in range, so he got no experience points with the kill. Or if he did, it was really, really minimal.
Yeah, maybe one of those times where you will finally see Jotam's Roaming Mirana actually fall behind in experience, just because he's not actually being a part of any of these kills. That was so close to our Bane, Yol, actually being able to get away from that Clockwork. They both had boots, mm-hmm. and if Bane had just been able to get ahead of that that continual mini stun of Battery Assault, he would have been fine, and they would have had a really great situation there. We probably still would have gotten a kill.
Looks like middle lane E-Skill's able to blink himself away in time. They're chasing up to God, but he'll put a March to the Machine's cover fire down, so he gets up towards the hill. Jotam, okay, now he didn't help out his teammate just then. Yeah, she took the bounce on over. So Tinker does go down. E-Skill's very low on life, and they're grouping themselves up just in case Jotam does a run. But hey, he gets level 2 now, so he can't go for a run. He could now, because he has Leap. Should also point out, like, how the hell is Solon really meant to win this bottom lane when Liquid Fire doesn't proc your magic stick charges?
Yeah.
Because it's just continuous spam harassment coming at him, which is ditching out a huge amount of damage. He's not even getting an advantage for it. Like, the Ice Pass is the only thing that's triggering it out.
A win in this lane is getting a deny on your tower.
Yeah.
That's like literally the only winning scenario here. If you get a deny, that's like, nice. You won your lane. That's the best you can do at this point in time. Gank a top lane.
Oh, 8 Mother. That's actually a good time lock over on Seedoy. Just slowing him down a little bit. But yeah, he needs more of that. And he could have committed Chrono, but his teammates were too far away.
Yeah, he judged that the Bristleback was just not quite low enough. If he got an extra time lock, he probably would have committed the Chrono. But it's just one of those sort of things. You make the leap, and if you get the good enough RNG, you throw down Chrono. If not, oh well.
He could have gone for the arrow then. They saw Frigaleap move up into their shop. Mm-hmm. With Gone right behind it, would have been possible. And when he was up there too, he put a fresh sentry ward over on the Ancient Stack.
Yeah. Smart, but again, I'm surprised we haven't seen BZZ already rotate. He's picked up his level 7. He's got that Liquid Fire.
He doesn't need to. This is what he does, man. He's trying to make space for other heroes. And Solon, hey, it's a lot of damage. Going to hookshot into Yol right now while BZZ, he's copying a lot of little bounce damage, but Macropie's available. Liquid Fire's available too. He slows down Stevstyle, who's using most of his mana to regenerate. The Bane still goes down. Let's melt into the creep wave that was there. But the whole point of BZZ is the fact that he brings other people to him. He doesn't care if he dies, because the Bristleback and the Tinker then make up for it, because they get a lot more space. There's your hookshot down for Stevstyle. Here, Ice Parts, a little bit off target. He's under 30 life points. That Liquid Fire is hurting so bad. And can he cuts his way out.
Rack it on. Yeah, it only takes one tree to be able to get yourself out of that little area. But, the way I've seen BZZ run in the past, though, is they rotate him around to take all the Tier 1 towers. And I thought that was going to be their play here, mm-hmm. because Tier 2s are obviously much harder to take, just because rotations are going to be happening, towers naturally a bit tankier, etc., etc. So I expected him to be going for the much easier gold of Tier 1s, because that frees up a lot more room for Tinker, because they're going to be rotating around to try and stop the Jakiro push.
Oh, they found E-Skills. Can he get the Nightmare? Not in time. And no Fiend's Grip leveled up by Yol. He wanted to make the most out of that smoke before he comes back here and de-wards that sentry ward, which he can quite clearly see unless he's being blocked by... Okay, he wants a better range hero.
Yeah, Bane's range is too so bad he'd take like 400 damage from the Ancients in the process of doing that counter. But yeah, the easy gold of Tier 1 towers. I thought, you know, faster boots of travel, the faster blink dagger, etc. But...
BZZ staying in the trees for now. I don't know if he's waiting for extra support or his new creep wave to arrive or Solon to actually move down. Oh, that's it. He's just going to wait for him to move down and then come in from behind. Which means with the Liquid Fire, there's no other choice but for the Clockwork to hookshot into the Jakiro and just run away and hopefully get a good power cogs.
He needs a teleport, though, because he can't do this by himself. Maxed out, Battery Assault, Clockwork is still really dangerous, even if you're taking away his attack speed.
Look at it. It's coming up the side. It's a TP scroll on the Courier.
Okay, then.
It's trying to be a little bit more... Yeah, no. He's feeling it. He's like, wait. Someone's still here. Someone's still here. Courier takes movement speed. He's going straight back over the top so we can see where Solon is. And then TP's himself out while middle lane, the Bane's going to go down. The Wish Doctor bounce stun. It looks like Shadow Strike Scream and Sonic Wave all committed to kill that Bane too.
Yeah, and he almost denied himself. He tried to sleep himself there towards the end, but wasn't the perfect timing. I'm a bit surprised we didn't see the Treads build for BZZ in this game. I thought he would just because tanking up against the Chronosphere is always helpful. But instead, he went for the more aggressive, I would say, laning pickup of Phase Boots, which obviously gives him a lot more harassment versus heroes like Clockwork.
I like this from BZZ. He'll kill off the One-Eye Fish Ward. Looks like up on top lane too. Chrono's been committed on the Bristlefang. Okay, with the Bounce Stun and the one creep that's still there, they can hold him. The Nightmare's over on Frigolite, and the Nightmare actually taken off by Stevstyle. That arrow, not going to come in time. The Ice Path will, however, connect over on the Witch Doctor. There's Bane, while Void jumps in. No Chrono, remember, but he's going to have a crack here at BZZ. Bounce Stun, it goes down to Jotamon. Yol and Jotamon locked in positions here. Ice Path back off cooldown. Connects with Ape Mother. Can they get close enough, though, to really do anything about it? Liquid Fire hits both Ape Mother and the entire Creep Wave. But God's not ready to be part of this. His BTs are coming out in the Courier right now. And that's not too bad. 10-minute BTs in for a Tinker whose ancient stack was screwed around with a lot.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think his timing was very well done. Big help from Jotam, who is very gimped because of all the help that he helped out middle lane, but is sitting at level 3. But still, it's still like, if you land the arrow, you still get a kill, even if it's only a level 1 or level 2 arrow. So it's not that big of a deal for them. And now here comes the push. I guess they were waiting for actually being able to get the extra security of March and the Machines when they push down these towers.
Maybe. Ape Mother's currently stunned up for a very, very long time. Now he comes back out of it, but the tower's already gone.
Yeah.
There's Liquid Fire of cooldown in 1 second time, and that's going to slow down Ape Mother. Hookshot in by Solon. BZZ needs to put a nice path down right now to stop this attack. And she managed to catch out E-Skills with that too, with the hookshot in. Ape Mother still very low, though, inside the macro pie the whole time. The arrow forcing the Void to run up high, keeping him in range of Seedoy. And with the March of the Machines cover fire, it becomes a one-for-one trade-off. E-Skills has his Sonic Wave of cooldown now. He could technically jump in, but I don't think there's enough damage to get the kill here.
Another one of those lineups that is very much you're facing up against Virtus,
kill.
Bro.
Courier kill. The illusions are going for it. The ice bar stopping the illusions from attacking. That delivered in the mech for Jakiro, so it's still worth the peril of bringing the courier in.
Virtus Bro's lineup is designed to be able to fight pretty continuously, whereas, again, Coast have gotten this lineup that have very, very long cooldowns. You have the Chronosphere as well as the Queen of Pain ultimate. If the Sonic Wave was up in that last team fight, it could have been entirely different, but. And unfortunately, it's such a long cooldown at level 1. And, it's always a long cooldown.
Solon and the Courier managed to meet again. He's in point-blank range here. The Rocket's going to fly his way. And Seedoy, we're just going to town with the Ice Path as well. Solon's not walking away from this one at all. And E-Skills, he's even got two Bristle Sticks in the back of him. And now Seedoy, run to the other side. The Witch Doctor Alderman's going out. Quap Baldi as well. All to kill off Seedoy with a Macro Pyre. Doing a lot of damage out of Ape Mother. The Ice Path as well has got Leap in 5 seconds. It's too long. The Nightmare holds him there, so the Jotam Arrow will continue to get the kill, continue the stunning and hold on that Faceless Void. So the Bristleback might be down, but the pushing Jakiro is still up, while God is taking care of every other lane. He's down the bottom lane right now, and sees a Clockwork TPing in. Hookshot's actually off cooldown for him, so if Solon wants to initiate, he could. But it's a level 1, so Tinker just gets some range and he's good now.
Yeah, normally when you're fight manning like this, you end up missing out a lot of golden experience from some of the other lanes and maybe end up gimping yourself, especially in levels. But with the Tinker kind of like soaking up about half of that experience by always being able to move to the other lanes, they don't take as much of a hit in that regard. So I really do like this Tinker pickup with the aggression that the Jakiro offers. And again, like the Coast, they threw down a Chronosphere there on a Bristleback. When you have these long cooldown ults, and that's the only way you can fight, you have to look for those perfect opportunities. And unfortunately, getting a solo Bristleback with his back turned to half of your team is not really the ideal setup. Even if the Void had lived, that would have been a lost fight for VP, just because they couldn't fight anybody else.
Is E-Skills really considering this? Clockwork's got a hookshot, but With Icepath down, the Liquid Fire also on the tower. It's a bit of like, it's a double-edged sword because it's slowing down the attack of the tower. Now BZZ needs his Icepath to cope. He's got it on cooldown. He's trying to get the Macro Pie. The arrow will connect here on Steph style. Jotami still got a 4-star to get himself out while the Fiend's Grip going on Solon. Ape Mother jumps up. There's no Chrono available. Solon low on life. The Starfall from Jotam finishes the job. Leaps down. He's right next to Solon in the tree line. The cogs will lock him in together. Jotam one more attack. Gets it off. Moves to free leap. 4-star down. Oh, it almost gets all. Roshan wasn't even aggro by that. Cedo will die at the tower. The entire time VP are fighting underneath the tier 1 tower. And the Bristleback might consider himself rather unlucky. He did die at the end of the day to the creep wave of Coast.
Yeah, and the Mirana died as she leapt out of the cogs and ended up getting, you know, hit by the burn damage on the way out. So, yeah, there could have been a much... It was very, very close to being a really good fight for Virtus Pro, but fighting so early underneath a tier 1 tower... that the upside here for Coast is they want to fight or drew even in a team fight without Chrono or Quap Ultimate. So they're actually ready for the next attempted push from Virtus Pro.
Mm-hmm. Right now, man, if you're going to be ready for this, however, you're going to be a full life and full mana if you're going to try and survive this lineup. The Vanguard has now arrived in as well for the Bristleback is running up the middle lane. Liquid Fire is going to get the tower. They do fortify it. And the Liquid Fire is just going to be applied again. With Rockets and March Machines, Narrow's being thrown out. They keep him back from the tower, so denial isn't possible.
I think they really wanted that Mask of Madness for the Faceless Void, and I think that's why the Glyph, they wanted to be able to take a fight there. They wanted Void to be able to initiate onto the Tinker.
They'll have it at Tier 2, man, because there's no way VP is stopping this push. But that's a good March Machines hook in. Someone's going to cop a lot of damage right now, especially when Brain goes for the Brain Sap. Then an arrow connects onto E-Skills. Nasal Goot run on top of him. The Ice Punk can make sure Quap remains where she is. And just how much damage they took. They dived underneath the March of the Machines. And not to mention the Cool Spray at the same time. That's such a huge amount of damage coming in to such a big area, too.
They have such good initiating tools up against a Tinker, but they're not really finding the openings to get onto Tinker for whatever reason. Yeah. The Hookshot as well as the Chronosphere.
Nightmare.
To get that.
It's
going to
be taken off right now by somebody else. Dev style, the arrow, it does connect, which means Tinker, Laser. Yes, he gets pushed back by the Cox. Now Ape Mother.
Chrono.
He gets the Chrono, but the March of the Machine's killing off Dev style. And while Ape Mother, he will take the kill over on the Tinker, the Tier 2 tower has still gone down. So it's a little bit of a collateral kill.
I mean, they finally get that Tinker, but it's been so long. They should have been able to pick him off more because they have such good single-target lockdown. If the Clockwork hits the Hookshot onto the Tinker's dead. Mm-hmm. Same goes with the Chronosphere because both of those ultimates set up the Skywrath Mage ultimate. So you kind of guaranteed 600 magic damage on top of that hero. Maybe a Queen of Pain scream or even the ultimate being committed. There's so many different options.
Solid. He's going to go for a Hookshot right now on Jotam. He leaps down. Well, hey! Ball stopped himself through. He connected to Yol with the Hookshot. But Jotam slid straight past it. Yol, he can't protect himself. Now with a Brain Sap, he's got Fiend's Grip available. He's going to let it go right now, but he can't. He's into the tree line. E-Skill's going to chase him down on this one. While BZZ, there's your Fiend's Grip. So the Queen of Pain will die at the back end of play. Well, we've got the Faceless Void running himself away to safety, and the Clockwork, the man who started all of that, is also back to base. And this Tier 2 tower is also toast.
And Team Coast's playstyle here is, I think, really turning against them. They like to be able to fight. They win their team fights usually by out-executing their opponents. I feel like they're really good in that regard, but they're fighting up against a lineup. They just can't win. They can't actually be taking these fights. They're going into March of the Machines. They're going into a mech advantage and a gigantic gold lead for Virtus Pro.
Yeah. It's going to get bigger and bigger, man. Clockwork, he doesn't have a hookshot, so he can't initiate into this. In the meantime, all BCC's got to do is just keep throwing liquid fire on that tower. And it ticks out. But looks like VP will back themselves up. We have a full run of Aoi. Ape Mother, he's found himself. No. He backed up.
Really, he wasn't. He was trying to get his Chronosphere is going to be up soon. He wants to do the wraparound to be able to find a really good initiation for his Chronosphere. Going straight through the front door is not the way to catch out this Virtus Pro squad because you see they're
they got
all staying spread.
The arrow follow up too. They're trying to hold him there. And BZZ, he's still got the Macro Pyre available. You are right, Ape Mother's looking for that entrance in through the side. It's just so hard to get. They've lost their tower as well on the high ground. The March Machine wave is just so ridiculous to walk into. So even if Void did get the Chrono off in this box, you still got Coast having to walk down their hill into a double wave of March of the Machines.
Exactly, which is why he needs to be able to wrap around and catch them out in maybe like the first march. Like, when God first positions himself to start spamming out those March in the Machines, you got to catch him within that first March. If he gets off two or three, there's no way the rest of your team can follow you up.
Notice, too, what God's doing. He's got to keep his eyes on the other lanes, because them pushing in really helps him off. But at the same time, Coast, they're too late. The double wave March in the Machines will mop up the wave in the mid. The Tinker's already back at base, like, regenerating. And they're going to actually loop all the way around the back. Wow, this actually really worked for him.
They may not catch the Tinker, but they might be able to force the fighter on Virtus Pro without
Bane's
the
one
Tinker.
Coming in. Where's that arrow flying? I think it's having a bit of a fish in. Void, he leaps up. He got the Chrono. It's only on Jotun, which means BZZ can get the Ice Smart. Ape Mother, nice little dodge. Walked himself out of that one. The Wish of the Stuka, he's own ultimate off, but then quickly cancelled off. Zevstar's trying to run himself out this one. BZZ is still part of the fight, and that initial damage from the Liquid Fire killing off the face of Void. Where Solon hook shots down, but it means they're just in an ice path. The Liquid Fire connects on both of them. The Breathe Fire level is the first time we see a leveler at a level 12. Giving a double kill over. Witch Doctor, he's trying to juke around from illusions of Seedoy. They finish the job with one last Quill Spray. This will be bottom racks right now.
Yeah, Team Coast, they knew where they were really on the ropes, and they were looking for that one opening. Unfortunately, when they went for that initiation, Virtus Pro were not grouped up like they were hoping they would be. And the Chronosphere on one is obviously going to play disaster. And even that one, they couldn't kill right away. And God was able to teleport in and start laying in that rocket damage.
So with the bottom racks, we've already got the push coming in from Bane, in the middle lane. This is a Bane walking around with a Blink Dagger and Arcane Boots as well. And looks like Tinker's going to force out the top lane a little bit more, but it's just going to be adding continuous pressure on that mid. Waiting for another team fight to be open for him. Seedoy might need to find a better way of getting some mana regeneration in. Because he can't spam up as much as he really wants to. He's got 13 1 charges, which is nice. So that'll give him his mana pool he's looking for. Comes up towards the high ground, bounced on BZZ, careful. She just miss uphill with the Liquid Fire? I think he did.
Yeah.
East skills are still waiting, but he's Shadow Striking onto a Jakiro.
Nice, we now have the full halberd up for Seedoy, so he can actually disarm.
He's got no mana for it. He's got no mana for it.
Well.
Even with his one charge. Now he does clockwork, hook shock in. He's got two of them, but the arrow's already going to connect. So they bring him down. The Mystic Flare does some serious work, but the cogs actually not making it easy here for Ape Mother. But they got the Takiro down. Fiend's Grip holding Ape Mother in position. The Starfall from the leaping away Mirana will do the job there. While God's got a huge wage march to the machines in through the bottom, he's going to rearm himself up under the cover of Ghost Scepter. He's going to back off cooldown again. Laser, rocket connects on the Witch Doctor. In comes Yol. Nightmares one, Brain Saps the other. The Urn charge from Jotun, as well as the attack. That's actually. Oh, Zevstar's going to counter the negative Urn with a positive Urn. But BZZ bought himself back so he can just come straight back in towards this middle lane.
Yeah, God did too. He's like, you know what? We got this game right here. We can take the second set of racks. There's no way Coast can actually fight us without that beautiful Chronosphere setup. And yep. It still had its down, its pitfalls. You had the beautiful positioning there from Yol, who was able to Fiend's Grip the Faces Void inside of the Chronosphere.
They're jumping down. They're going to get revenge on Yol. Then again, he's four stars down to the cover of the March of the Machines. The Macropie also forcing back Solon as well as Stevstyle, including the rockets from the Tinker. And man, there's so much you got to worry about. Spotting an arrow in the middle of this too. Stevstyle getting locked. Void jumping in. Still no Chrono, but they're able to nuke down the Tinker in this case. While BZZ being mini-stunned up by the Paralyzing Cask, they will be able to bring him down with a Battery Assault too. Four-star out, Meg Charge as well. He can turn for an Ice Smart at the moment, and he just turns, in fact, for something else. And that's for the Rod of Aoi. Slowing down the Faces Void. Seedoy, the Nightmare. Now Bristleback lets off the Cool Spray. And we get the kill. Solon's got a hookshot available. He's going to have to hookshot himself up. Now he's going to try and TP out of this one. Maybe not the greatest thing in the world. Bane able to get the last hit in. And in fact, now jumps up. Nightmare's over on the Queen of Pain, which means arrow from Jotun. It will still connect, even though the Nightmare was taken off by the Skywrath Mage. The Chrono will go from Ape Mother, and he focuses on BZZ, one of the tankiest heroes right now in the front line. And he can't kill him. Four star back, even with the orb attack from Frickly, wasn't enough, and Seedoy back into the warpath. Look at the damage he dishes out. It's a triple kill. Rod of Aoi again being used on Ape Mother. Leaves himself back to safety. But really, it's GG. There's nowhere safe left inside the base. Virtus Pro will take the victory and advance themselves through into the lower bracket consolation final, where they will play up against the loser of our first game tomorrow, which is Empire versus Tinker at 18 CEST, as the MSI Beat It 2014 Global Challenge is coming to a close for the European qualifier, at least. Only one team is allowed to get through. Only one team. Our grand final's on Sunday, but we'll have our lower bracket consolation final, as well as the winner's bracket final, tomorrow from 18 until basically midnight. So check out joindota.com for the live stream links if you need them. Or you can be right here on twitch.tv/joindotared. That'll be available right here. And of course, we've got more action coming up tomorrow where we have the MSI Beat It Chinese qualifiers. They'll be beginning on blue at 10 CEST in the morning. The I-League matches will begin at 13 CEST. The Joindota League Southeast Asia Finals will also be on with Scythe versus Invasion. We'll be starting the live stream on Joindota Red, and if we need to, game number 3, if it does happen, we'll switch over to Joindota Blue when the Beat It winners bracket and lower bracket matches do begin. So yeah, we'll have great Dota coming your way tomorrow, and of course on Sunday, the We Play matches. We got Euro Finals as well as Asia Finals, Southeast Asia Finals, Community Channels, Blue Channels, and Red Channels all up and running all weekend long. So Joindota.com will be your place to be watching the highest quality Dota over the weekend. And of course, if you want to stick around, I don't know if Cap actually wants to sleep, considering he's back here in 12 hours time.
No! Sleep is overrated.
In that case, we'll stick around and do our casual talk of Dota. If you want the Skype link, if you're a subscriber, you'll have an email sitting inside your box. I'll send a new one out now if you have just subscribed as well. And all you gotta do is add the Skype call and let us know a topic which you'd like to talk about, and we'll take your call. That simple. It's gonna only be short, like maybe 30 minutes, maximum hour. We're not gonna be here all night long. But yeah, casual conversation. If we run out of callers, we'll take questions from the chat. So yeah, stay tuned, and we'll be back for a little bit of casual talk Dota.